Terry Carr, and I'm the worship leader this morning. All are invited to come and play euchre on Monday at noon in the fellowship hall. The community lunch will be serving meatloaf, peas, mashed potatoes and gravy, and fruit on Tuesday between 11 and 1. Please come and enjoy. Vacation Bible School is this week on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday evenings at 6:30. All are invited to bring their children, grandchildren, neighbors, people off the street, we don't care, ages 4 to 12 to join in on the fun and learning. Asbury is holding a one-day giveaway of elementary children's clothing for back to school on Saturday, July 20th from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. for children who need some gently used items for school. Please check your insert in your bulletin for additional announcements. I ask you to please rise and join. I'm sorry.
I have a screen challenge update announcement today. During the service one Sunday in June, I announced we had received a challenge. If the congregation would fund one new sanctuary screen and the installation costs for two, money for the second new screen would be provided. Well, that screen we need to do will be a gift from the Memorial Fund. Our installation costs, as announced, were a low guesstimate. The actual costs for removing the current screens, which are about 10 and 15 years old, replacing them with 85-inch screens, and doing all the connection work is $1,607 because of the location, the weight of the screens, and the need for professional installation with a company who can and will provide troubleshooting if the need arises. The good news is that we already have received $955 toward those costs, so we only need an additional $652. Our goal is to meet that total by the first Sunday in August, so the trustees can give final approval and we can get this wonderful enhancement in place. We will not add a screen in the overflow area at this time, as costs are way too high. Any donations received above the actual final cost will go into an audiovisual designated fund instead of the building reserve. As we all know, electronic equipment needs frequent updates and tweaks. Thank you to all who have already donated toward this challenge, and an additional thank you to all who will help us wrap up this challenge. Donations should be marked for screen challenge and can be placed in the offering plates or dropped off or mailed to the church office. Thank you.
Thank you, Carol. Now I ask you to rise if you're able and join me in the call to worship. Sorry. What begins with a dance may not end with a flourish.
Let us be sober in all that we do.
A careless word, a foolish thought.
Either can lead us astray.
Power and prestige ensure nothing.
So let us trust in the Lord our God.
Please remain standing if you're able for the praise team as they sing, as we all sing, Better Is One Day.
Thousands elsewhere, thousands elsewhere. flesh cry out for you, the living God. Your spirit's water to my soul. I've tasted and I've seen. Come once again to me. I will draw near to you. I will draw near to you. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day thousands of swear. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than thousands of swear. Thousands of swear.
Come. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Make yourself at home in us and among us. This day, O God, our quote-unquote sanctuary includes our worship space in this building, as well as our parking lot, and at all the homes and places where people may be joining us this week. So, great Spirit of God, we ask that you fill this sanctuary as we have defined it, with your love, with your presence. Please move among us that all disease, that all distraction, that all negativity and worldly concerns that take our focus off of you, might be removed. Kick divisions and clickishness to the curb. That this space may be one for all of us to be safe, to draw close to one another, and to draw close to you. May all of us, including the quote-unquote others in this world, find sanctuary and the love of Jesus here. Great Holy Spirit and beloved children of God, may all of us be welcome in this space as we touch the presence of God together. Amen.
How sweet the sound that Good morning, church. How many of you have heard the phrase, it's complicated? Me? Nobody has heard that? It's complicated. What's complicated? Oh, pretty much life. It's complicated. Praying is complicated. Okay, I don't actually believe that anymore. I used to. I used to believe that praying was complicated. I no longer believe that. Now I'm like, yep, what you get is what you see, God, here you go. And it's not complicated for me anymore. But for other people, praying is still complicated. They're like, I'm not going to pray in public because I don't do that well. Okay, that's cool. I'm fine with that. And other people are like, I don't really do good prayers. I come from a long line of, there's no such thing as a bad prayer. They're all a good prayer. If you're talking, then like, you know, it's cool. But I will say this. Sometimes I pray differently. Okay, all the time I pray differently, those of you who'd heard me. But so when I'm talking to God the Father, so I tend to be a little more cleaned up. Let's go with that. Because God is the Father. When I'm talking to Jesus, I tend to be like, bro. Because Jesus and I, we're tight. It's like a friend. He's like a brother. A brother friend. So a lot of times it's like, bro. Now, let's talk about the Holy Spirit. That one. I'm not really sure about that one. Because it's like, do you talk to that one like God? Or do you talk to that one like Jesus? Bro. So when it comes to the Holy Spirit, I just kind of be like, take the wheel. It's all on you. You figure it out. It's not my job. I'm going to pray the way I pray, and your job is to figure it out. So yeah, prayer can be complicated or not. Because any prayer is a good prayer. Every prayer is a good prayer. Doesn't matter what it's pretty and whether it comes off like a pretty pastor who does pretty things or it comes off like me and you go, oh man, did I say that? Because it's okay. Because the Trinity, who by the way, the Father, the Son, the Spirit, that's who that is. The Trinity, I'm pretty sure you knew that. They don't care. As long as you're talking to them, they don't care. They'll figure it out. They will figure it out. So it's cool. I like it. So with that, instead of a repeat after me prayer, we're going to have a few moments of silence. Pray in your head, or you can do it out loud. To whichever one of the three or all three that you like. Ready, set, go. And with that, we all say, amen. You guys have a great week.
Our scripture today is Mark 6, 14 through 29 from the Message translation of the Bible. King Herod heard of all this, for by this time the name of Jesus was on everyone's lips. He said, "This has to be John the Baptizer come back from the dead. That's why he's able to work miracles." Others said, "No, it's Elijah." Others said, "He's a prophet, just like the one of the old time prophets." But Herod wouldn't budge. "It's John, sure enough. I cut off his head, but now he's back alive." Herod was the one who had ordered the arrest of John, put him in chains, and sent him to prison at the nagging of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife. For John had provoked Herod by naming his relationship with Herodias adultery. Herodias, smoldering with hate, wanted to kill him, but didn't dare, because Herod was in awe of John, convinced that he was a holy man. He gave him special treatment. Whenever he listened to him, he was miserable with guilt, and yet he couldn't stay away. Something in John kept pulling him back. But on a pretentious day arrived when Herod threw a birthday party, inviting all the brass and blue bloods in Galilee. Herodias' daughter entered the banquet hall and danced for the guest. She charmed Herod and the guest. The king said to the girl, "Ask me anything. I'll give you anything you want." Carried away, he kept on, "I swear I'll split my kingdom with you if you say so." She went back to her mother and said, "What should I ask for?" "Ask for the head of John the Baptizer." Excited, she ran back to the king and said, "I want the head of John the Baptizer served up on a platter, and I want it now." That sobered the king up fast, but unwillingly to lose face with his guest, he caved in and let her have her wish. The king sent the executioner off to the prison with orders to bring back John's head. He went out, cut off John's head, brought it back on a platter, and presented it to the girl, who gave it to her mother. When John's disciples heard about this, they came and got the body and gave it a decent burial. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please join us in singing "Seek Ye First," number 405 in your pew music.
Let us pray. Speak your word of truth, O Holy Spirit of God, that we who are present might hear and understand. Speak truth to the powers of this world through us, declaring to all that your triumph will come through the church in the name of Jesus. In us may you find receptive hearts, minds, and spirits. Come upon us now, O Holy Spirit, in all your fullness. Come as never before, and may it be your word delivered by your Spirit that flows lavishly throughout this sacred space today. May each willing spirit receive what they need for the day, for the week, for the journey ahead. Amen. A foolish promise. Admittedly, not a cheery passage of scripture. But let me start with this question. Regret. Who has ever had a regret in your life? Now, I'm thinking you know what that is, but just to be clear, regret is defined as this: a feeling of sadness, repentance, or disappointment, It's a feeling of sadness, repentance, or disappointment over something that has not happened or has been done. Sadness, repentance, disappointment. Not really feelings that I can honestly say I look forward to. Yeah, good Christians want to repent. But do we really, or do we just want to get it right and pretend that we did if we didn't? Regret, repentance, disappointment. If regret involves a person or a relationship, that regret can actually outlive the relationship or one or all of the people in it. Regret can actually cause people to die from broken spirits and or from broken hearts. Now, I apologize, some of you have heard part of this story, but I want to share it because it relates to the message. My father and his father were never close, and my father spent his entire life wondering why. He was the only child, so that made him the firstborn son by definition. He was a good-looking lad, a dutiful, hard-working, I-aim-to-please kind of son. He was adored by both his sets of grandparents, by his mother, and by several uncles. But his heart was broken because his father never seemed to love him. For a variety of reasons, including his broken heart, my father died very young, unlike his one uncle, who lived actually right here in Columbus at 1100 East Broad Street, apartment 3-something. It was a really nice senior citizens building back in the day, and I found out since then it was the same building that Stan's parents lived in at the same time, and I actually interacted with them without knowing that. But my elderly uncle lived there. Now, I can't explicitly remember if he was in his 80s or his 90s, but he was not a young man when he died. And I believe that his death, when it came, came because of his regret. He lived a long life because of his strong faith in God and his positive outlook on life, but he had regrets. You see, my uncle, for most of his life, was a jovial, talkative fellow. He smiled and laughed and enjoyed good health right up until the day my father died. Uncle Arthur was never sick a day in his life until my father died, and he was never well a day in his life after my father died, because Uncle Arthur died of a broken heart, and he knew that my father died of a broken heart too. Now, I've told some of you that my father's heart was broken because of that lack of love from his father. He died from a sense of rejection and a lack of understanding as to why he was rejected and unloved. And I should add that my father's death didn't come immediately after his father's death, but he was never well after his father died because all hope of a relationship or even of understanding died with his father. So my father's heart broke and he died. And then Uncle Arthur's heart broke for a very different reason. I told you my father died from a sense of rejection at the one person he wanted love from the most and not understanding why. An only child, shouldn't your father love you? But Uncle Arthur's heart broke from regret because he knew what stood between my father and his father, and he never told. Even after my grandfather died, Uncle Arthur never told. Up until the day he told my mother and me after both my father and my grandfather had died. And Not that long afterwards, my uncle died too. At the end of the day, many lives were made difficult and many hearts were broken, all because of one foolish promise. You see, my grandmother's parents were people of means. They were black farm owners when black people didn't own property, much less a thriving business. And my grandfather was an humble man, a lowly preacher's son, surely not good enough for my grandmother, who, I should also point out, was the cherished only girl in the family. Uncle Arthur confessed years later, in grief and tears, that he knew all along that this was the issue. His mother was actually the family matriarch, the head of a dairy empire. So she called my grandfather aside and made it clear that he would be tolerated, that he would be allowed to exist in the family, which meant he would have access to the family's resources if he had nothing to do with my father. That was to be left to my grandmother, his wife, and her family, lest my father might somehow be tainted by his own father. That was the implication. It was to be his mother-in-law, and not him, who would see to the proper rearing of his son. And were he to renege on any part of the deal once it was made, she would seal the deal by seeing to it that my father came to despise his own father. That was her threat. And with that, a very foolish promise was made. See, my grandfather agreed, and he stuck to the promise. Now, once the truth was out, Uncle Arthur had another confession that he carried an abundance of anger in his heart. My father's entire life, he was angry at his own mother. He was angry at his sister, my grandmother. He was angry at my grandfather. And he was angry at himself for lacking the courage to do what it would take to make things right. He regretted that he let his fear add to my father's heartache. And he was afraid that my father would hold him accountable for not intervening before it was too late. He was afraid of looking cowardly. And most importantly, he was afraid of being the same greedy person that my grandfather was. That he was afraid of being cut off from the resources if he got out of line by telling about the promise. So much heartache and grief stemming from one foolish promise. What would have happened, I wonder, if my grandfather had simply said, "I've worked to make a living my entire life, so I'm going to keep on doing that, so no deal." What if he had just said that? Beyond a world of broken hearts, I think we'll never know. Just like we will never know. What would have happened had Herod not made his foolish promise to Herodias' daughter? What would have happened if Herod had just simply kept his big mouth shut? Beyond a world of grief for Herod, beyond the death of John the Baptizer, I guess we'll never know. Foolish promises often involve fear, and foolish promises are often made in haste. And all too often, foolish promises have effects that can't easily or ever be undone. Let's look at Herod's foolish promise. Jesus' name was on everyone's lips because the disciples had a ministry all throughout Galilee. Teams of disciples traveled far and wide, calling people's attention to who Jesus was by telling their stories of what Jesus did, of what they witnessed, of all the miracles. And people knew who Jesus was. Anyone who was everyone suddenly knew who Jesus was. But Herod must have wondered who Jesus really was, though, because clearly he didn't believe that Jesus was God's son. So, like many others in that time period, he tried to come up with some explanation. How did Jesus have the power and authority that he did? So what was Herod's likely explanation? More likely than Jesus was God's son, he proclaimed that John the Baptizer had come back to life in Jesus. Now, what we do not know is precisely what did Herod mean when he said that John the Baptizer had come back to life. Maybe it was grief and guilt that caused him to conclude it was John. The Philemon Bible commentary offers these thoughts. Either Herod was thinking that the spirit of John the Baptizer had come to rest on Jesus at his death, as the spirit of Elijah had come upon Elisha. Or he was saying figuratively in exasperation, "This is John the Baptizer all over again." That's the end of the quote. We don't really know. But what we do know is that the text recounts the events of John's death, and it's not pleasant. It's terrible. It's idiocy. It's appalling. And it shows what anger and fear can do. It shows how anger and fear can lead to a foolish promise with dire consequences. First, let's look at anger. Herodias had it, and John paid the price for it. Another commentary, the Life Application Study Bible commentary, offers this background. Palestine was divided into four territories, each with a different ruler. Herod Antipas, called Herod in the Gospels, the one we know as Herod, he was the ruler over Galilee. His brother Philip ruled over Trachonitis and Iturea, a different region. Philip's wife was Herodias, but she left him to marry Herod Antipas. When John confronted the two for committing adultery, which is what that was by their standards, Herodias formulated a plot to kill him. But instead of directly trying to get rid of her sin, trying to make things right, she tried to get rid of the one who brought it to public attention. That's the end of the quote. Herodias was angry at being called out for her sin. She was so angry she hated John. But Herod respected John. So Herodias just waited. Anger, that was the first part. And then fear. Another motivating emotion in this scenario is actually fear times two. According to biblical historian Josephus, there was a political reason for everyone in power, which included Herod, to fear John. This was because he was greatly popular, and popularity could be used to start a revolution. People feared John because his followers were fiercely devoted. And it's just like what happens later in the not-so-distant future when political and religious leaders will fear Jesus' popularity enough to kill him as well. Then, as now, even today, fear of the inability to hold on to power has led to a lot of foolish promises. So there's that fear of the inability to hold on to power. And then there's the fear of looking foolish in front of people that we love and or respect. It's the fear of not being able to save face, the fear of losing our dignity, our honor, our name, and thus perhaps our place, our authority, or our power. For perhaps both, but certainly the fear of looking foolish, Herod succumbed to pressure and kept his foolish promise. What does the scripture say? Herod arrested John the Baptizer. But you know why that is? He was baptized. He was arrested under pressure from Herodias and the advisors. The anger that she had and the fear of holding on to power that the advisors had. Though Herod respected John and his integrity, in the end, he had John imprisoned. In the end, he had John killed because of fear, because of pressure from peers, from family, from those he respected. Now, I know it sounds stupid, but lest we judge too quickly, ask yourself this. When is the last time you bent to peer pressure? How long has it really been since you said or did something against your better judgment because you let someone that you cared about persuade you to do that? And then let's hold off on that lie, I don't care what anybody thinks, because we all have somebody whose opinion matters. It's really easy to say, I don't care what anybody thinks, but all of us care about somebody or somebody's opinion. There is that person or persons that we want to think highly of us, so much so that what they think and what they do affect what we think and what we do. Maybe it's one person, maybe it's two, maybe it's a whole group, but every one of us has somebody who can put pressure on us to do or not do something, to think or not think something, to say or not say something. For Herod, it was all the black brass and blue bloods in Galilee, which is hard to say, all the brass and blue bloods in Galilee, or other translations put it this way, the high government officials, the army officers, and the leading citizens of Galilee. It is in front of this group that Herod opens his mouth, puts his foot in his mouth, and steps into some serious mess with his foolish promise to Herodias' daughter. What do you do when you make a foolish promise? We already know what my grandfather did. We already know what Herod did. And those are not good stories. The gravity of Herod's promise is made clearer by the reality of some of his words. Point in fact, Herod has no kingdom to give to Herodias' daughter. Think of it as this. He is a ruler given authority by the Roman Empire. The empire belongs to Rome. The place he reigns over, the kingdom, belongs to Rome, not to Herod. So to offer Herodias half of his kingdom was to offer half of nothing. There's wiggle room there. Had he not been blindsided by surprise, coupled perhaps with the fear of looking foolish in front of his distinguished guest, Herod could easily have played it off, and he could have let John live. A foolish promise handcuffed by fear. Psych! I gotcha! I was just kidding, because half of nothing is nothing. You can have half my kingdom. You can have all my kingdom, because I don't have anything to give you. You can have half my promise. I'll let John keep his head and you can have the platter. There's a lot of things that Herod could have said. He's the one in the room with power. So there's a lot of things he could have done. Of course, the easiest thing to do is not to make the foolish promise in the first place. But even after he made the foolish promise, he could have shaken off his fear and been a leader. Instead, he kept his foolish promise. How simple would it be not to make a foolish promise in the first place? We all do foolish things for a whole lot of reasons, and I'll venture to say that it is likely all of us, at one time or another, have made foolish promises. But here are the questions. What moves us to make those foolish promises? And then what do we do after we've made those promises? Herod's promise cost a life. My grandfather's promise cost quality of life for several people. There's a price to be paid for making and keeping foolish promises. My grandfather didn't want to lose access to money and resources. Herod didn't want to lose face. What is it that you don't want to lose? That's the very thing that can be behind you making and keeping a foolish promise. In a world of instant gratification, Could it make a difference to do something as simple as pausing to pray for the guidance of the Holy Spirit before you make a foolish promise? Could it be something as easy as opening the pages of your Bible before you make a foolish promise? Could it be something as simple as phoning a Christ-like friend before you make a foolish promise? We're still talking about creating spiritual practices, actually, things that can change our hearts and minds. So think about what I just said. Before you do anything, do you make space to pause and pray for the guidance of the Holy Spirit? Before you do anything, do you pause and open the pages of your Bible to see if there's something in there that might give you information so that when you make your promise, it's not foolish? Is it a practice for you before you enter into promises, no matter how urgent they may seem, to phone a Christ-like friend and run the idea by them? It's a dynamic world and things happen at breakneck speed, but we don't have to move at breakneck speed. Sometimes we have to pause and give God time to tell us what to do. Yes, like Herod, like my grandfather, we all make foolish promises sometimes, but we don't have to keep making foolish promises. We can be ready even with when we're surprised by a request like, I want his head on a platter, or I want control over rearing my grandson. We can stop. We can reconnect to our bigger than surprise and bigger than fear God and ask God to help inform this promise that we're about to make before we make the promise. Because when we do this, there's no limit on how many lives and how much quality of life can be retained and restored. Sometimes it just takes saying, I need a moment, to realize that the urgency is more implied or imagined than is actually reality. My grandfather didn't want to lose money and resources. Herod didn't want to lose faith. What is it that you want or don't want that you might leave at God's altar so that it can help you not make a foolish promise too? What is it that makes you susceptible to foolish promises? What do you fear? What kind of power are you struggling to hold on to? Those are at the forefront of foolish promises. All of us, at some time, if we haven't already, will in the future make a foolish promise. But what do we do after that matters? What we do before that matters even more. We can always pray. We can always study the Word. We can always come in contact deliberately with somebody who we know is struggling daily to live a Christ-like life too. What is it we need to lay down that might help foster that sense of urgency that drives us to the foolish promises that hurt life and quality of life? Something for all of us to think about as we struggle daily to live and love like Christ in a more and more alienated world. Amen. Let us prepare our hearts and minds to go to God in prayer, which is our number one defense against foolish promises. This morning, as we go to God in prayer, we pray for the family of Betty Satizon, who passed away in Florida, where she was living. We pray for Bob and Becky Soles' nephew, Tim Trites, who was in a serious motorcycle accident in North Carolina on Friday. We pray for Sunny Heron, that her doctors might finally be able to help her with her health issues, because now your test results are in. Courtney Watson asks for prayers for the people of Jamaica, so we want to remember the people of Jamaica and the people of Texas and all the places that have been impacted by this ferocious weather that the world has seen. And we want to pray for the brokenness in our nation. We are surrounded by broken people doing broken things. I don't care who you are or what your religious affiliation may be. I don't care what your political affiliation may be. What happened last night is a travesty because wrong is wrong. So whether you vote Democrat or Republican, or whether you choose to vote at all, we can't continue on this path, and the church has to lead the way because none of us can be healthy and whole until all of us are safe and healthy and whole in our homes, in our schools, and in our communities. So we ask that God start healing us as a nation again, and may the church be the place where that can begin as we model loving God and loving neighbor as Jesus intends. We also want to praise God for loving us and sending Jesus to die for us, to despite our brokenness. Jesus died anyway, knowing that everything that's going on in the world today, that's everything's going on in the church today, that's everything that everything going on in our lives today would happen. Let us pray. God, as we speak to you today, we speak with hearts that are fearful and broken. Our polarized nation feels like it's in a free fall. Once we were concerned with the well-being of all people, just as Jesus modeled. Yet today we feel more divided than ever before. Not only do we not care about our neighbors, often it feels like we actually outright hate them, or they hate us, or our disdain for one another is mutual. We can no longer agree that a human being has the right to free speech unless they say what we want them to say. We no longer want individuals to have freedom unless we choose the freedom that they get. It's not enough anymore to live and let live. Instead of that, we need to live and help flourish. But we don't do that. We refuse to do that. We want to judge and control as though controlling someone else, as though beating someone else down and stepping on them will fix the brokenness in us. But we know it won't, oh God. All of us know that deep down. So help us first work on our individual brokenness. Come into our hearts, our minds, and our lives. And first reveal our brokenness to us. Because some of us are oblivious and some of us just don't understand. Reveal our brokenness and urge us to offer it back to you that healing would begin in us. And as each of us begin to heal, all of us, the whole community, inside and outside the church, can begin to heal in the name of Jesus. God, we don't like change, but change is necessary. We confess in this post-COVID era that we're change weary, oh God. So weary that we reflexively resist all change at this point, even when the change is good. God, we do it as a reflex because we're tired. Please address our tiredness. Help us stop reacting because a lot of the change that we resist is your change. Help us focus on you. Help us be the community you have called us to be, because your power in community is more than enough for anything that the world may offer. Lord, forgive each of us for the sins that we have committed, sins intentional and unintentional, that we could be whole and free and available to offer Christ, so that Christ would be on the lips of everyone in our region too. Help us remember what you have said in your word to us. Help us love and serve and forgive as Christ taught us to love and to serve and to forgive. Please receive into your care and cover with your special attention, O God, each person and each circumstance that we have placed on your altar today. You know intimately what each person, each circumstance needs. Provide that, we pray, as hastily and as completely as is prudent. We will entrust the particulars to you even though that's really hard to do sometimes. Please unleash the fullness of your love and your power upon us, all of us, those that are like us and those we do not like. Forgive all of us, fix all of us, and help us all be like Jesus. For it is in his name that we pray. And right now, it's in his name that we pray together the prayer that he taught us with these words. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Won't you please stand as you are able and join in the closing hymn, number 529 in the hymnal, How Firm a Foundation. We ask the Holy Spirit to shepherd us, to guide us, that we might keep our hearts and minds and eyes focused on Jesus. May we study God's word, speak honestly and often to God, and may we rely on God's Spirit to lead us in all things we do. This way, we can move in God's Holy Spirit and not be distracted by fears or the desire to hold on to power. As we sit and live and breathe in God's Holy Spirit, we might not be distracted into making foolish promises that can trip us up and diminish lives, our lives or others. As we stay in the Holy Spirit, we are enabled and empowered and authorized to go forth in love, to go forth to serve, to go forth and be God's church. Let us do that with passion this week. Amen.